We are live at the Key Live number 13. How are you doing today, Alex?
I'm doing great. So, and I'm really excited. This topic is so excited that I'm PTO, but I want to make sure that I want to be joined this call because trusty AI is a so hot topic that I couldn't miss.
Thank you for joining during your PTO. I bet you won't regret because the guy we have here today is a specialist. He's special, but he's also a specialist in Trusty. He's one of the architects working on the key group on that. So he's the architect, actually. So he's been working with technology for almost 10 years now and almost 5 just with business automation. And I want to see his perspective on why he thinks we should, what he thinks we should do in order to be able to trust our AI.
Can we trust AI?
Can we? Let's ask him. Hi, Daniele. Thanks for joining today. How are you doing?
I'm good. Thanks for inviting me to this this session. I hope I will be able to answer. Sorry?
Grazie.
Prego. We can do in Italian if you want. I mean, I don't know if you are able to follow it entirely, but we can try.
The recent sessions, we had the Brazilians. So as Karina and I are Brazilians, so it would be fine. But now Italian put us on the edge.
Dani, so... Yeah. I know it's pretty, we've been already speaking about like how process automation can help organizations, how rules automation can help organizations, and also how we can connect maybe AI with decisions and make it more intelligent. And today you are going to tell us about what we need to do in order to trust these intelligent decisions. Is that correct? This expectation?
Yeah, actually, I think that this session is perfect that it's going to happen after the one of Edson, because Edson already covered the history of decision automation in terms of role decision, the fact that now it's also possible to mix with ML algorithm, so you can enrich your logic, and also at the end of the presentation presented the pragmatic AI definition that we're using with building blocks. So you can compose a lot of stuff. You can have much better decision automation and in general business automation solution. And today we're going to show also other aspects that you should consider, especially if you are, let's say, a company, because if you are just playing with AI, usually, okay, you just download your image recognition system. You can play with FaceApp or any kind of apps that, okay, just play with that. But if you want to make, let's say, a business on top of it, usually you need to consider a much bigger picture. And this is I hope that today I will be able to explain some other aspect that usually it's not the first aspect that you think about when you approach AI.
Yeah. And so we go beyond. So today is still getting started, right? So we covered some beginning topic, but as AI feels like if we go a little bit deeper than it used to do, but we go beyond it's a cat or not. So it goes beyond that.
Yeah, that's the point.
Okay. So, yeah. One particular, before you start, and I think you will cover a little bit, but I have a question for you. Why?
Alex.
Yeah, go ahead.
Before you ask your question, while he's asking his question, please tell me, send me a hi, send me what time is it right now for you. I just want to see you there, feel you here with us. So, Alex, now you can talk while I chat with these awesome people here on the chat, okay?
Sure. Thank you, Karina. And hi to everyone in our audience. I have one question that you and I, part of this group, and Karina as well, we've been asking this question very common. Why? The our group are investing on AI. Is it related to the field? How it's connected? Could you help understand that? Why we now are doing that?
Yeah, actually, I think that first we should, and this is one of the first slides that we'll have. We need to define what AI is, because historical AI it's covering more or less everything. So decision automation, it's an AI topic. So machine learning, it's part of AI too. And the reality is that traditionally you started to maybe do simple business automation with just applying a couple of rules. Now, you know, you have a much better algorithm that can extract knowledge from your data and you won't apply them. But the reality is that you still have to face all the decision logic that you needed to apply. So you cannot just say, okay, switch off one and switch on the other type of AI. The reality is that usually in an end-to-end solution, you need all of them. And the key value is to integrate them in a way that can, let's say, benefit from both sides.
That's a great point. And that's we've been doing, like AI today, we are so connected to machine learning, right? So yeah. We always talking in a machine learning and AI seems to be the same thing. That's not exactly that. So when you're looking to decisions, business rules, we've been doing AI for a long, long time. So we are doing effectively AI, and that makes just, we are just expanding with trust information that you want to go cover that. Thank you.
Yes, exactly. And the last thing that I'm curious to see in your presentation is because when we are talking about a business application, we have many different personas. So we have the business analyst, we have the person who actually implement the rules, and we have the data scientist when we are talking about AI. So yeah, I want to see how you are going to explain everything for each of these personas. And if you are actually, I don't know if you are, but if you are going to, that's what I want to know. One of the things I want to know, okay?
Sure. I will try to cover everything.
Let's get started. What do you think?
Yeah.
It's time to. So, Daniele, the stage is yours.
Thanks, Karina. By the way, feel free to interrupt me if there is any question or we can keep it for the end. Okay, so let's start with the presentation. We already touched some of the points that are part of the presentation. So first, let's define what is artificial intelligence. So there are really a lot of different definitions. I'm taking this one from Wikipedia. So in general, artificial intelligence is intelligence demonstrated by machines. So it's a really big topic, and it's not specific to deep learning, so it's not specific to neural network, it's not specific to machine learning, so it's not specific to statistical method to train your machine, but it's a really general topic. Historically, or one of the, there are a lot of different classification, but in general, usually we have two different main approaches, symbolic AI and subsymbolic AI. So symbolic AI is based on logic and rule, and subsymbolic is based on statistic learning. This is just a definition, but of course there are many other definitions. So let's start with something that is brand new, Prolog. So late beginning of 70s, it was already AI because it was a symbolic AI. You will be able to specify your rule, you will be able to specify your fact, and then the engine ask with a query was able to infer, so to decide, to create new knowledge. So you are not specifying exactly the answer of sibling Sally Eric, but the engine was able to apply the different rule. Rules can be used exactly for this scenario. So you can define a rule, you can insert multiple facts, you can define a query to extract your information. And so this is already AI, it's symbolic AI. And as mentioned, said during the last session, rule and decision, they are strictly connected. So this DMN, it's just a sort of higher level abstraction. So we have a decision table, for example, or we can compose multiple nodes in a DMN. But the reality is that you can decouple your decision logic. And then, of course, internally, a decision table contains multiple rules from a feature perspective. So they are all related to symbolic AI. Of course, we already know the answer of this question. Of course, this is a type of AI that is really powerful and fit really well in some scenario, but is not covering all of them. So for example, one second back to original Prolog. One of the things that is really simple with symbolic AI is to add knowledge. So if I know a new fact, I can just insert it. If I know a new predicate, I can just insert it in the system and the system will use it. While if it's a statistical learning approach, I needed to create probably to retrain my model. So at the same time, I can do tracing. So they are two different approaches. Both are valid. Of course, with different ML algorithms, as soon as I started to touch this topic, there are a lot of different algorithms. So even if now it's probably machine learning, it's probably assimilated to neural network, it's not only neural network, clustering, linear regression, there are really a lot of different algorithms that can be used to learn from data. So that's the key aspect that distinguish symbolic AI with some symbolic. So you are learning from data and you are generating some relation that was inside that are inside the data. So of course, picture classification, image recognition with cats, of course, it's one of the first example that you can run if you just approach image recognition. And the reality is that to train your image recognition system, you don't need to specify why that image, that picture contains a cat. So you don't need to explicitly describe the shape of the hair, all the size of the eye. So the system is able to find the relationship automatically from the data. Same for a recommender. So a recommender, usually it's a way to classify your customer and then define if there are multiple, let's say cluster, multiple characteristics that assimilate a customer. Then I have a new customer, I can see the distance of a specific, let's say, behavior, a specific cluster, and then recommend the other product that are part of, that are been bought by the other user from that cluster. So in this example, I see that these two persons are similar, and one of them already has also the product C. So I can recommend the other because I expect, considering that they are similar, I expect that they will that they are interested. Again, this is not something that has been designed up front. It's something that emerged from the data. Another really important feature of ML algorithm is the fact that they usually are better than symbolic AI to handle noisy data. So for example, if you think about a random forest, I will not go into details, but you can consider to have a sort of aggregation of multiple decision tree. So there is a decision tree. Normally it's really quite strict. So I have my feature age, and then I have multiple boundaries like greater than 10, lower than 5, and similar, and apply them. And for some reason I have a noise in my data. So age, I got age with value 10, but the reality was 9.5. Okay, I'm just taking the wrong path and I'm done. I mean, I'm not really fault tolerant. While this kind of algorithm usually are able much better to handle noisy data. For example, if I need to understand the direction of distribution of those data, I don't really care of the fact that the data really, let's say, they distribute, so they're not really following a single line. Then this is a recap again for what we discussed last week. The reality is that you don't need to choose one of them. The reality is that you can and you should probably want to just compose them. You have a machine learning, you have digital decisioning, you have mathematical optimization, and probably in your system, you really need to have all of them together to have a pragmatic AI solution. You can do it with open standard, like was been explained last week. So you can use open standard that help you to, let's say, to shape your model from a case perspective, a process perspective, a decision perspective, or an ML perspective. You can compose them and you can have your end-to-end business automation solution. Done. Okay. I can close the presentation and it's already done.
That's fantastic. However, yeah, I think now we got an understanding of the landscape, right? Yeah. So we see that we have the predictive models, we have the rule side, the decisions that, but now, no matter what you're using in your business, right, you want to have a better understanding what's going on, different from the cat. If it's a cat or not a cat, I think we're not breaking anything important, but what we can go beyond that, how we can understand what's going on.
Yeah, that's a good question because, of course, when you use AI, especially ML, you are not usually considering the fact that AI can go wrong. And when an algorithm, and let's say when a rule goes wrong, the set of result that it can provide is fixed. So it could be a wrong result, but let's say an expected wrong result. While a function, so usually ML at the end, it's a function that has been trained, can provide the result always, even if has not been trained to provide a result of a specific value. So the result could be really bad, badly wrong.
Okay, so I'm looking forward to what's next.
Yeah, and I will show just a couple of examples of when AI goes wrong. So this is a quite famous example. It's from some years ago, but I think that it's important to remember that, for example, even Google, and now I will show a couple of examples about a big player. So I'm not saying that it's like a small startup that created a model like using no data because they have no real data. So we are talking about, the key player of the market. And in this case, Google Photo was not able, was wrongly classifying sometimes African-American, so black people, as gorilla. And of course, this is a huge error, both in terms of result, but also from a reputational perspective or a discriminational perspective. So the error itself has a consequence that is far beyond the simple result, because of course, in Google Photo, you are not really buying anything on top of it. So actually the fact that has been wrongly classified is not a direct impact, but the reputational problem that generates, it's huge. And this, it will become a money impact on the company. And it's really funny also the fact that after a couple of years, because the original news was from 5 years ago, the fix was to remove the label gorilla, because the reality is that it was not able to train a model that always was able to distinguish, maybe with considering different lights or considering different scenario, because of course, when you train the image, maybe you start from a quite plain image with the person without any background. And the fix was, okay, I will not classify any gorilla, so I will not have this risk. Another example is about Amazon, when they tried to improve their recruiting tool using AI. And they realized after some time that the model that they created has a bias for women. So if the word of the resume, I think the text or could be the curriculum, contains the word woman, that text will be wrongly classified. And again, this is another really important problem, because AI we don't want an AI that discriminates people, of course. And this is really a recent example. It's like 3 days ago. This is more funny, let's say, but of course the people will add a problem for that. There was an AI powered camera that tried to replace human during a soccer game in UK, I think, but it's being wrongly trained, and there was a referee that was bald, and he was not able to distinguish the ball. And it's quite funny, if you look at the video online, you will see that there is the team that are playing the ball somewhere. And after a while, the camera was just moving back to the referee. Of course, it means that a lot of people that were trying to look at those football games from home wasn't able to enjoy the game. So there are a lot of different ways for AI to go wrong, and even more, there are also regulatory requirements that need to be satisfied. Especially this is a GDPR, is probably the most famous, and it's a European regulation, but it's not the only one. And of course, it's probably the first law that has been created with this meaning. Was also covering a lot of other privacy concerns, but also was trying to handle and to approach AI and automation, decision automation. And of course, they were not going into much details about, okay, when a decision based on AI it's good and when it's not. They were just trying to propose general concern that you needed to satisfy, like you needed to provide meaningful information. What does it mean meaningful? Of course, it's not simple to define. But the idea, they are starting to add at least the requirement that you cannot just say, okay, that's the output of the algorithm, because if the result has an impact on people, the customer can ask to understand, can ask, for example, for an explanation. Can be, they need to be able to challenge those decisions, because of course the fact that the decision has been processed by a machine doesn't mean that it's correct. So I can dispute, I can challenge a decision that has been taken by human, and they need to be able to challenge also this kind of decision. So there are a lot of different aspects that need to be considered. And this is more or less the reason why we created this trust initiative, I think more or less 1 year ago, a bit less than 1 year ago. And the goal was, okay, try to approach AI and the type of concern that you have in an AI system when you wanted to, especially when you want to move to production. So you have maybe a model that it's good from your point of view, but to have a system that you can trust to have in production, you need a lot of additional capability. So you need to be able to monitor the system, to understand what's going on, both from a, of course, from an operational perspective, because you want to be sure that the system is answering with providing results and similar, but especially from a business perspective. So I want to understand, for example, if the distribution of my decision is changing. So maybe it's a symptom that something is wrong, like maybe the model is not is no more a good fit because has been trained with data that are no more valid considering the real world data. Because after a while, of course, people can change behaviors, and also model need to be updated. Tracing. So considering the fact that people can challenge or should be able to challenge a similar decision, I needed to collect data. I needed to collect all the also the internal logic, the internal information, so that in case of challenge, in case of audit, for any kind of purpose, I can come back and say, okay, this decision that has been taken, this decision has been based on this and that information, and those was the step that has been made. And the last one that is probably the more let's say advanced as idea, because it's quite specific for ML, or in general has been designed originally only for ML, it's explainability. So one of the problems is that traditional rule engines can actually expand and say all the steps that has been performed, while an ML model is usually a black box. And in a black box, it's really hard to understand what's going on. And in our scenario, targeting pragmatic AI, so mixing ML and decision, they're having the possibility to drill down, instead of just have the output like loan has been rejected, understand why, and not only following the decision table, but also following the ML logic. So having this kind of drill down to explain his decision, it's really a powerful concept.
So just the last before you go, I had one question. So yeah. What you're telling us now is this initiative, the Trust AI, are a mechanism to open this black box?
Yeah, we are trying to make those kind of internal information available to the user. And one of the points that correctly raised Karina at the beginning was the fact that the reality is that we don't have a single user. We have different persona that are involved in this process. And they needed to have probably a different type of answer, because as end user, okay, I can, for example, generate a set of KPIs that try to justify that the model has no bias. But okay, if I am the user, I just get, okay, this is my list of feature, and this is the list of KPI that has been generated. Thanks, but so what? What I can do with this kind of information? I'm not neither able to understand. It's like if you go to the doctor and to explain what the doctor is saying, you just give you the whole book of, okay, if you study this, and if you learn everything that is inside this book, you will understand why that's my decision. I mean, that's definitely not the type of explanation I can provide to the end user.
And I got it. So you are providing these mechanisms will not go into the details of all the points that were made, but you give a higher level understanding on the business level what is going on. Is that correct?
Yeah, exactly. So we are aiming to target all the personas and to define what's the best way to explain a decision and provide insight of a decision, considering exactly the type of the behavior, the type of the characteristic of that persona. So it could be higher level, could be lower level, could be more domain specific, because I'm not saying that, let's say, only data scientists can understand the decision, because, for example, the case worker, so the one, the bank manager, so people that are knowledgeable of the domain can understand if you provide information like, okay, to take the decision, I'm using the risk score because it's a concept that I know. So that's the type of analysis that we did at the beginning to decide how to approach explainability in our setup. So in a pragmatic AI context where we have ML, decision, and we are mixing all of them.
Awesome. Looking forward to see more. What do we have?
So let's introduce, not introduce, I mean, I hope that is not, let's say, a new concept, but this initiative, it's part of the more general Cogito initiative. So the more in general, next-gen cloud-native business automation platform that we are creating. So of course, this is probably the most, the buzzword bingo slide. So we have a lot of different technology that we can use that they are all part of a microservices cloud native solution. And we want to use them because of course, we want a solution that is able to scale. We want a solution that is able to be monitored. We want a solution that is able to deploy, to be deployed just with a simple command. So maybe using the operator. We want to use Kafka. We have a lot of requirements that a modern application has. And just the fact that we are targeting business automation, this doesn't mean that we can ignore the technology behind, because a customer in general, a user, expect to have the same level of flexibility that general, let's say, microservice development approach provides. So this is just a picture of, from a runtime perspective, Cogito contains the proper Cogito apps that has your knowledge, your process, your decision, your ML, using, for example, PMML, that is a standard to serialize trained model, ML models. But there are a lot of different services that communicate each other using different channels. Could be reactive messaging with external services. Could be job service, if I needed to schedule a job, data index, explainable service. And if I want, let's say, to highlight what I'm referring to now with Trusty, I'm referring to monitoring dashboard, Trusty service, and explainable service. Now, going on with the presentation, it's probably easier to introduce a use case that can simplify the story. So credit card approval. It's quite simple scenario. So I have my end user that is going that is in front of the case worker and is asking for a credit card, and we have essentially here two different scenarios or two different questions that we want to, or use cases that we wanted to cover. So again, we wanted to let the case worker explain why a decision has been made. Especially, I expect if the card has been rejected, because usually you don't really need to, you ask why if the request has been approved. But actually, the GDPR is not specific to rejection. So actually, you can also ask why it's been accepted. And also, if it has not been accepted, what can I do? This is another quite important information. So another point, information that it's need to be considered. We already introduced a couple of persona. We are targeting different persona. We are targeting case worker, so that usually has a good domain knowledge, but has no technical knowledge. And at the same time, we have a compliance worker that it's more like something that know the domain from not from an operational aspect. So I don't know which form I needed to or which tool I needed to use to register a credit card request. But I know all the credit check that need to be performed. And then we have a data scientist that maybe has no or a few limited domain knowledge, but has all the technical skill that are needed to build the model. So let's start with the monitoring. So in this case, it's targeting more the compliance worker. So this is a screenshot from Grafana. It's not really important the details in, because of course the picture need to be zoomed in. But the idea is that you can monitor, because of course in the tool you can zoom in, you can open your decision, you can open your own panel. You can monitor in real time the decision that has been made. And for example, here you can see at least the trend. You can see that this is a green value that as far as I remember was approved is going up. and also the reject the number of decisions that has been rejected is going up again. So I can have this kind of information. Of course, the data here are not real world data, has been generated for a demo purpose. So they are quite flat. But if you imagine a distribution of your requests, you can imagine that you have maybe a peak of requests because of external reason. And you need to be sure that the system is behaving correctly. And this dashboard is generated automatically based on your model. So you model your decision in DMN. You can create a decision table. You can create multiple output. And then the Cogito, during the code generation that is performed, look at the model, understand how many decisions they are, the type of the decision, and generate a baseline, so a based dashboard in Grafana that show this. So the tool itself, Grafana, it's already flexible, but we pre-populate and we expose all those metrics so that you can have out of the box, starting from a model, so a decision that contains also ML, maybe, you can generate this dashboard. Similar, we have an operational monitoring. This is more related to, let's say, the service level agreement or that kind of KPI. So you want to be sure that, for example, all your requests are processed within a certain threshold, like no more than 100 milliseconds, whatever. So you want to see the number of requests that you have, number of error, if any, number, type of distribution of the return code. So maybe here you can see that you are starting to get a lot of 405 whatever requests, and this is information that it's important. Here it's a different persona too. It's a DevOps persona. Okay, for a DevOps persona engineer, a DevOps engineer is not probably the target persona for explainability, but for monitoring definitely is part of the story, because you need to be sure that the service, the system is up and running and is healthy. Also, those information are extracted. This dashboard is generated considering the endpoint that we expose. Then let's move to the auditor. Now we have an auditor that wanted to, there was a dispute, for example. I wanted to understand what's happened. So I got maybe this the idea of the dispute. I can access the audit UI, that it's a console that we created that consumes tracing data, so that you can automatically go through and see the data that are inside the system. You can choose one of the execution. You can see the outcome. So for example, in this case, in this specific execution, the credit card has been rejected with a level of confidence of 0.8. That is already an information that could be useful for an auditor to understand that the system was, let's say, quite sure about this answer.
Now look into this interface.
Yeah.
And by you say auditing, it's someone that's completely off IT, is it correct? It's someone that works on the business side, someone that needs to understand what happened because that mortgage or that something didn't happen or how it happened. So yeah, that's a different way to view. You're showing that we have all these capabilities in technical perspective, but we also provide in this interface an interface, a user interface that it targets the knowledge worker, someone that is going deep in the business. Is it correct?
Yeah, indeed, because we produce tracing information during the execution, and those data, of course, are published on Kafka. So if they wanted to integrate with another system for other reason, they can, but we already provide a way to consume and access those data in a way that it's high level and it's business oriented. So it's providing information that the user, that the business user should be able to understand. So I have the information, one of the decision was approved. So I know that this is the decision. I can see the data that the user provide. So all the type of, we are trying to shape, I mean, we are providing all the information so that the platform is flexible. So actually you can integrate and you can consume the data in different way, but we want to provide an end-to-end experience, and to provide an end-to-end experience, we need to cover different personas. And if you are not, if you are an auditor in terms of a bank manager or similar, you definitely want to have an high level interface that give you the information in a way that are, let's say, meaningful from a business perspective.
Absolutely. And because this is all open source, right? So I may not want to use this specific user interface for any reason. I want to adapt it to my company branding and colors and components, but I can use these as a very good example to build on top, right? Or I can even reuse these components. Is this correct?
Yeah. Usual. All our code, all our platform is open source. And actually, you have at the moment, you have the flexibility to, let's say, decide where to plug your customization, because if you are fine with the type of information that you provide, you can just change the UI entirely, rewrite and customize the UI that we have, and consuming the same REST API that the trusted service expose. While if you needed to have maybe you needed to integrate and store the data somewhere else or similar, you can directly access to Kafka, have the stream of all the information, process them, and integrate with your whatever BI tool that you prefer. So you have a lot of flexibility. You can just customize the UI. Maybe you want to change the logo. Let's assume that, okay, I'm fine with the tool. I just want to change the logo. You can do it. It's let's say, a plain React and TypeScript application. So also in terms of technology stack should be quite simple to customize it. Same for the services, because it's a REST application that expose a simple REST service. You have a really flexible environment. You can decide both from a technical and user aspect what you need.
Gotcha. So I want to see what more you have in this interface.
Yeah, let's drill down. And let's reach the explainability part, because I added information about, now I'm playing the role of a bank manager or in general an auditor, so someone that has knowledge of the domain, but maybe not really technical knowledge to understand the algorithm behind. So I already saw in the overview the output that I got. There are other sections that now I'm not going to show, like looking at all the input. I can see the model. I can have a preview of the model, a DMM model that has been executed. But I can also have an explanation. In this case, the type of explanation that we are showing is the feature importance. It means that you can choose the decision that you are interested on. For example, in this case, we have only two decisions, but you can imagine to have a system that has a much many decisions. And you can choose the decision that you're interested on, and then you will see the actual input that has been provided to that decision and the weight of each feature. It means that you can understand which of the feature has been used and add a positive contribution to the result, and also the feature that had a negative contribution. It's a classification essentially of the feature, and those feature. So it's not really important the actual score in terms of fixed value. It's important to understand what are the most positive feature. That the feature that has the most positive impact and the most negative impact. So this is a kind of a diagram. It's a kind of UI that in this case, if you read it, it's children is one of the feature that has been used to reject this request. So in this case, the auditor can provide back an information like, okay, I can then check maybe if I have I can drill down to the decision logic and see many information, but I can already have a picture, an end-to-end picture for that specific decision to see, okay, I know that I'm using this list of feature to take my decision. And actually, most those are the 2, 3, 5 feature that has been used to provide the result. So Now let's focus a bit more on explainability, because I expect that tracing and monitoring are key aspects, but how it works, or you can imagine how it works. While with explainability, probably it's a bit more complex. So in general, we aim to have a model that is transparent so that human can understand the reason of the decision, explainable. So provide an interface or provide a way that respect the decision taken and in a comprehensive way, but also trustful. Sorry. So I want a model that, of course, human are confident to use. Here, of course, explainable AI in general, explainability, it's a really big topic, and there are many different approaches. So here is just a quick introduction to the topic. So you have a local and global explanation. both are important. The explanation that I just shown, it's a local explanation. It means that I'm starting from a specific execution, so a specific point of a specific set of data, and I want to explain that one. So I want to explain why that specific output has been provided. While global explanation in try to classify the general behavior of the model considering the model itself. So, for example, in general, it's if you think about loan approval, you can imagine that your net income, it's information that in general is important, because if you earn, let's say, if you earn zero money, it's really hard. I mean, I would say it's impossible that your loan will be approved. So in general, in the, maybe in a specific execution, the net income has not been the most contribution, the top contributor feature. So in your local explanation, you can get the information that, okay, considering your scenario, net income is not the most important information, because maybe you have other characteristics that are guiding the decision. But in general, I expect that from if I move to the global explanation perspective, I can see that this is a feature that, let's say, from that has an impact on the result that has, let's say, a quite big impact. Direct interpretable versus post hoc, surrogate, static, interactive. I mean, I don't want to go too much into detail. The idea is that to give you a lot, some keywords, some data point that you can, if you're interested, you can drill down and better understand what is behind. So another step, now let's say deeper, the feature explanation that we showed has been based on a LIME algorithm. This LIME algorithm, it's a technique that it's a black box techniques that start from the actual data, the actual input, and the actual output that has been produced by the system, alter, create a perturbed version of that, and try to train an imperturbable model. So in this case, a linear classifier, because the outcome that we want, it's some weight. So we wanted to be able to classify each feature with a weight. So this is the way. So we are starting, we are considering the algorithm, we are considering the type of output that we can provide, and we are trying to understand which are the best fit to provide an information that is, in this case, is targeting the auditor, the bank manager. Another type of explanation that we are implementing that it's quite effective from and it's quite, let's say, simple to understand, it's counterfactual explanation. And it's also it is the second use case that I introduced some slides ago. So one of the quite common question that as end user I can make if maybe my card credit card approval, my credit card request has been rejected, is, okay, what should I do? Okay, give me how I can provide, I mean, I can change my input, so I can change my data to get the card. So the idea here is that I know the desired prediction. I have a starting point that is my actual data. I wanted to alter them in the way that is, let's say, they try to minimize the changes, because of course, again, let's think about loan approval. Maybe I know my loan request has been rejected. Okay, it's not really useful for me as a user if the engine will or the bank manager will just say, okay, if you're able to earn 10 times more money on bounty base, you can get your loan. Yes, thanks for the information, but I mean, if this is the only thing I can do, probably it's game over. I mean, I wanted to minimize this difference, because maybe I can tune some of my information, like, okay, can you provide an additional guarantor? Can you add whatever policy, whatever information to minimize maybe your risk? So we want the function, the constraint that we want to apply to obtain the result is to minimize the distance from the, considering the original input. And of course, we wanted to be able to, of course, obtain the desired result. To do that, we can use another technology that is part of our platform, that is the mathematical optimization part, OptoPlanner, to be smart in the way we explore the space. So let's assume that the boundary to that split, this is the line that split approved and not approved. And at the moment, my value is here is not approved. And of course, age maybe is not really, I mean, and of course, maybe if I was just a bit 1 year older, it's enough, but maybe also 20 years older. So I wanted to minimize the difference, and I want a system that is able to alter the information in a way that it's closer to the input. How can I do it? I can do it defining soft score and hard score inside Optaplan, the constraint solver. Because another point that I forgot to mention is that I can have some R constraint, like age in the example is not probably a really good fit because actually I cannot be older or younger. My age is my age. I mean, I cannot really do anything to change that. So why should the system provide me an alternative solution that asks me to change my age? It's useless for me. So I wanted to have the possibility to specify R constraint, like even the number of children I have. I mean, okay, I can do something like more children. I can also, but in general, it's not a feature that I want to tune.
Well, that's a possibility, right, Danny?
especially if you want to increase, you can, and it takes a while. If you want to decrease, actually, I think that it's illegal in most of the countries.
Danny, we could already like explain the decision done with Drews, and now we are using Optaplanner to enhance this explainability.
Yeah.
By creating these hard constraints on the attributes.
Yeah, indeed, we are using Optaplanner not only to find the solution, but actually to enhance the result, the actual data that I provided to provide a new solution. So
good.
It's not probably the most canonical way to use Optaplanner, but it's definitely a quite powerful tool and flexible enough to really to cover well this scenario.
Mm-hmm.
I will ask to Optaplanner, okay, alter the data, try to find another solution that, of course, as our constraint, approve it, because definitely I wanted to have my credit card approved, change the other value and provide me information. Okay, I'm already going maybe a bit too much in the details, but the idea is that if you think about, now that you have the system implemented, the reality is that from a bank manager, I can just select, okay, these are the features that I can tune. Maybe some of them are already predefined because again, age maybe is never tunable, let's say. Let's run the system, and I can have an answer from my end user. Okay, sorry, the card approval, the credit card will not be approved. But if you are able, for example, to if you have a car, maybe I can consider that your situation it's from a financial perspective is better. So I can give you a credit card. So I can provide meaningful information about what should I do to get my the desired output. Now this is just one of the last slides. If you are targeting the other persona, so the data scientist, there are other methods that are meaningful, but maybe are harder for someone that is not really able to understand the logic, the technology inside to follow the explanation. So this is a partial dependency plot technique that we implemented, and it tried to understand the impact of a feature, tuning one single feature and keeping the other fixed. So it's a visualization-based explanation. So it means that the output, the explanation that we provide, it's a plotted function. Of course, you need to be able to understand this type of diagram. But if you are targeting a data scientist, we expect that the type of skill set he has will be enough to understand also this type of explanation. So let's try to summarize what we are doing with TrustAI, focusing on explainability. We are creating a library with a lot of, we're already testing the integration with DMN, PML. Also, we tried the OpenNLP language detector. So we are implementing the algorithm approaching our scenario. It means a pragmatic decision automation, at a pragmatic AI automation system. So we are mixing decision logic of DMN or decision and algorithm and ML algorithm. But we are also exposing this explainable service as a service itself. So you can use the explainability as a library. Again, considering the type of flexibility that you want to provide, if you wanted to integrate a similar solution, you can start with the library, like you can do with Drupal. In Drupal or with OpenPlanner, you can decide, yes, I want to use it, let add the dependency, let write some Glue code and use it. But maybe I just wanted to consume my service. So we are exposing also this feature as a service, so as a microservice. From an algorithm perspective, we have already implemented some of them. We are working on the contrafactual or the generalization of the contrafactual explanation. We are working on the aggregate Lime global explanation. So there are a lot of things that are going on. And in general, we are also starting to approach fairness because, for example, one of the points that I'm not really touching in details in this presentation is fairness and bias. So, for example, I want to be sure that my model, considering feature importance, if the top feature is gender, I might have the impression that my decision can have some discrimination aspect to consider. Because it's hard that the gender is the most important feature. We are approaching global explanation using SHAP. We wanted to try to understand and classify different algorithm model in this case so that we can try to help user. In our solution, we are not really covering the model creation. Model creation is quite a general problem that you can solve with many different toolkits. You can use Python, you can use scikit-learn, you can use R, you can use also graphical tool. But at the end of the day, our goal is, okay, create the model in the way that you prefer, save the model or expose the model in a way that we can integrate. Let's integrate with the decision logic and let us apply explainability on this decision. But of course, not all the models or not all the algorithms are equivalent. So given the specific task, you can have multiple models that you can apply. And it could be useful for us if we can provide and guide the user to say, okay, you can create a model in the way, in this case, ML model, in the way that you want. But if you're able to select and to choose some of them, the result and the type of explainability and interpretability that you can get could be much better. And then also another key aspect is end-to-end accountability. So part of, especially from an audit perspective, part of the type of information that an auditor would like to have is to understand why the decision has been taken, but also why this model is in production. So who created the model, when has been approved, maybe also which training set has been used to approve this model so that I can have, a global picture of the end-to-end about not only the specific execution, but also the process behind. These are all key aspects that we plan to cover. References, it's just you can reach blog.kia.org to reach our key group blog portal. There are some introduction of Trust AI initiative. You can follow the end-to-end instruction to install. The screenshot that I took in this for this presentation wasn't from that specific demo, but you can approach that. You can use that instruction to install and test using Kubernetes, OpenShift, or Plasma. I mean, in general, it's a Kubernetes-based environment. We have a sandbox repo where we usually do our experiment, and you can look at contrafactual POC. You can have blog posts about monitoring explainability. More blog posts will come in the next days, months. And then you can reach us, as all the other team of Kia, using the Kia Zulip chat. We have a stream, Trust AI stream. The whole team is there, let's say, every day. So if you are interested in something, you can join, ask.
I see. So if they have questions, they have a chat. If they want to learn more by reading, they have posts. If they want to try it out, they have a end-to-end demo with step-by-step instructions.
Yeah, I hope that is enough, at least for starting. Then join us and provide feedback, and we are more than happy to have also contribution. But I hope that both the introduction that I made and the links that we are providing are enough to get a better understanding.
That's pretty awesome. And also for those who are interested on the counterfactual explanation with OctoPlanner, we have a whole presentation just about it with Daniele, Tommaso, and Rui, correct? That we did on the OctoPlanner week. It was pretty a great presentation you did there.
Yeah. Some of the slides came from that presentation, but in that case was more specifically about counterfactual. So yes, if you are interested in that specific aspect, definitely have a look.
Yeah, one thing that you just mentioned that's, I think it's very relevant in these days, it's especially this fairness and bias. Like we are living in a world that diversity and inclusion is so important. And the volume of data that we collect is huge, but doesn't necessarily mean that's the quality, right? Because that is generating this bias. And that has an impact. That was fun. Some pieces were interesting and fun, like the bald guy and the ball of the soccer. But there are so much consequence of these algorithms that have been integrated in our daily lives, especially gender, race, and so many things that are affecting we as human beings. I'm so excited that we are trying to help in this space.
Yeah. It's as soon as you approach artificial intelligence, there are also, of course, ethics concern and a lot of different aspects to consider. And as human, we have a sort of bias with artificial intelligence because we expect artificial intelligence to work better. But the reality is that usually it's trained using human data. And if human has bias, the model will have bias. So we cannot expect that someone who has been trained by you and will behave much better than you. So it's important that you try to monitor. The important part is the fact that we have metrics, we have techniques to try to measure this kind of bias. So first, at least I can decide, okay, my model is not good enough. Then there are techniques to try to, let's say, remove the bias from the data. Of course, as usual, it's not. There is no gold. There is no simple solution for this kind of problem because let's assume that your data set is completely biased, and if you remove all the bias, you are removing all the data, so you cannot train your model anymore. So it's really important. And the reality is that it's not something that we will solve. I expect that it will take a lot of time to really solve it, and it will be really important to learn what AI is, especially because you needed to choose the proper tool. We like to see demo like, okay, especially about image recognition and similar, because you see neural networks that are changing images, that are doing a lot of nice stuff. But the reality is that there is much more than that. And actually, that example is probably the more trendy or the more appealing example. But it's also the example that where you really have no control. Through Twitter, you can if you publish a picture that are quite high, and Twitter will decide the preview where to place the preview. The reality seems that Twitter itself, even today, it's preferring white people and compared to black people.
It's still not fixed.
It's still not
fixed. Issue is really polemic.
I read the engineers involved in that. They try hard to avoid the bias. But as we talk about quality of data and the data that trains the model, it's super complicated. It's not a simple problem to solve because you need to normalize the data. But you cannot exclude all the data, right? As you mentioned, otherwise you don't have stats data enough. So that's super complicated topic. And that's when see that we as a key are trying to provide some inputs, like we're part of the big world in technology, but being trying to help and with this is amazing.
Yeah, I think that the best part is that we have architects like Daniele trying to bring this explainability for process and decision automation and intelligent process and decision automation. So I think this is like a key feature that every digital transformation, every company that goes through a digital transformation process should have in mind. At the end of the day, there will be a Karina at the phone asking, why didn't you approve my credit card, Mr. Bank? And you need to explain why. And if you have a black box, you won't be able to explain it. So, yeah, I just love Trusty. Anyway. So, Alex, do you have any extra questions for Dani?
No, I don't. He was very clear and sharp, I think, in the message. I think you... I can't wait till we get more of this. Like, I was reading the what's next slide. Like, wow, where can I start trying these things?
Excellent.
Yeah, it's open source, so you can contribute. This, of course, is not, I mean, you already know that, but also people that are listening, feel free to join the chat. We are open to contribute by ourselves in other projects and to get contribution.
Awesome.
Excellent. And I will share the slides from Daniele later on our GitHub link, the traditional one. So every slide deck that we had since the Key Live number one is there. I will also add the slides from Daniele. If you're still not subscribed to the channel, do it now so you don't forget. And so you can be with us next week with me, Porcelli, and Eric Chabel. And we will talk about how we can actually integrate business processes and business rules, because we've talked about both of them. We've talked about how we can make them intelligent, how we can explain it, but not how we can connect them, right?
I can't wait to see everything working together.
Also, we have one last question before we leave. Should I bring it from Stathis? Yeah, of course I'll bring it, Stathis. So how deep can the explainability go towards decisions made with PMML models, Dani?
Okay, the example that we are showing and in the library that we are testing, it's already, let's say, possible because the type of techniques that we are, the type of algorithm that we are approaching at the moment are algorithms that are being designed for black box model. So the fact that you have directly an ML model, like directly PML or directly another way to interact with the model, or you have a decision like a GMM that internally invoke the PMML or internally invoke a different decision logic, it doesn't mean that you cannot apply the technique. So the technique, it's really a black box approach. So the reality is that we can explain a pure decision based on decision table, I mean, a pure decision-based automation, or you can have a completely ML-based automation. And we expect that most of the scenario will be a sort of a mix of both.
Excellent. So let's allow Alex to go back to his PTO right now. And thank you, Dani, for joining us today. It was pretty clarifying the session. And I'll probably bring you later here to talk more deeply about the technical aspects of how we can do this. But for now, thank you for the getting started on Trusty.
Thank you very much, Daniel. It was very, very good.
Excellent. Porcelli, I will let you go back to your PTO. And you, that who's now at home watching us, see you next week.
Okay, thank you. See you. Bye-bye.